Belinda presents this unabridged recording of In Certain Circles, written by Elizabeth Harrower and read by Deidre Rubenstein. Part 1. I hear Russell laughing. His mother spoke in a troubled, haunted tone. Zoe moved instantly from her chair to sit on the rail of the veranda. She looked across the garden to the tennis court where four figures ran to the net and paused, arguing some fine point of order. "That's not so unusual. He laughs quite often. He makes me laugh often." It was impossible not to smile. Zoe adored him. But her mother's unnecessary grief did make her feel embarrassed. She had no talent for this sort of thing. After all, he was alive, unlike many of his friends. He was home from wars and in one piece. Having done history for matriculation, Zoe knew, and thought her mother might not realize as fully, that men had always been coming home from wars. It was more natural to rejoice. Certainly, she gazed in sudden depression at the four now running backwards to the corners of the court, like figures attached to a maypole. Certainly, the papers had for weeks and months been printing horrible facts, terrible facts. For a while, she hid the newspapers, and everyone was irritated and mystified and blamed a neighbour's dog, a cocker spaniel, famous for such depredations. Then, suddenly, they stopped talking about the dog, so Zoe knew that she'd been seen and gave up. Newspapers were awkward to dispose of anyway. For a week or so of warm weather, she was always going for walks, one arm held stiff against her side, sweating gently all over inside an enveloping coat. Over her shoulder, Zoe glanced at her mother with apprehension. For the years he was gone, perhaps dead, she had outwardly altered little. When he was restored to her, and her worst imaginings were not only publicly confirmed but outstripped, she aged, fading visibly, as if some inner stiffening, some secret resource, had quite disappeared. She was quieter, paler, powdered over. Everybody noticed. Zoe felt it was not like her to be seen to be shaken. It made her seem weaker and mortal. Zoe was surprised and resentful. Now, against her hand, she could feel the warm stone of a supporting pillar of the veranda. She had been born in this house. Down on the court, the game continued. Mrs. Howard eyed the distant antics with the dismay of a one-time A-grade player. "Your poor father," she murmured. "They probably think they're doing him a favour. I don't think I can bear to watch." Having restored his family to life by returning alive, Russell had proceeded to alarm and disappoint his parents by refusing to involve himself in any of the activities they felt him suited to. So he took up a racket almost before his father was aware of needing a game. "You might have played instead of that little girl. At least you have some idea." Mrs. Howard rose from the low bamboo chair. "I'll get some cold drinks. That will give them an excuse to stop." "But it's so hot. I'd get burned." Zoe touched her pale cheek. "Anna's fair too. She probably goes brown just the same. A lot of fair people do." Zoe yawned and slid her fingers again across her smooth white face. "Nobody plays tennis anymore. You could have an Olympic pool down there. I wish you would." This had been said before. "Be nice if they come up while I'm in the kitchen. You know Anna's a little orphan." Zoe gave an indescribable sound of disgust. She rolled her head about, seeming quite unable to recover. A little orphan? Anyway, if she is, so is her brother, and you can't pretend he's pathetic. In one beautiful, impulsive movement, she was at her mother's side by the door, smiling into her eyes, eager, appealing, high-spirited, but meaning no harm, teasing, but vulnerable. Why didn't you have a game? Her voice was soft, almost caressing. I get breathless. Do you want any help? Should I bring out the drinks? You sit down. It's all in my mind what I want to do. I'll call if I need you. Mrs. Howard looked at her daughter with admiration and love, patted her shoulder, and went inside. Zoe lay down again, staring across the garden, past the camphor laurels, to the place where her father, her brother, and her brother's two newfound orphans ran about in the sun. Whether the expressions so recently shown on her face belonged to the luminous quality of her eyes, or to the shape of her mouth, or to her nature, neither Zoe nor her mother yet knew. She was only 17. Zoe had wakened in this square stone house on the north side of Sydney Harbour and learned soon afterwards from her family and their friends that she was remarkable. There was a big garden. There were people of her own size for company. At the end of the short street of old houses in long-established gardens was a white curved beach with rocks, rock pools, very small waves, shells, pebbles, fine sand. She swam before she walked. Once, on a school tour to view relics of old colonial days, a girl carved her initials on the smoke-darkened stool in the anteroom of a courthouse. They were queuing to enter the cells and inspect the irons clamped on the necks and legs of convicts in another world. In a fiction, they disbelieved entirely. The pupil with the knife was pounced on. Ah! Patricia has just reassured future generations about the date of her visit. They'll be so interested. An outstanding girl like Patricia. The girl mumbled. Her companions brooded. The teacher, much tried, told them, "You're non-entities, that's what you are." Could anything be worse? Especially when it was not even true. Zoe was one of those whose parents were referred to in newspapers and magazines as well-known identities. Her mother and father were biologists and had written textbooks and others for the general reader, which had been published overseas. They had travelled. They were invited to join public discussion groups. They were interviewed and photographed and were on the list of those whose opinions on every subject, from crime to mayonnaise, were expected to be of interest to the whole city. Mrs. Howard was a useful example of a woman who combined a successful career with a happy home life. Whenever such a phenomenon needed illustration, journalists and producers were as likely to think of Alice Howard as anyone else in town. If you could believe what you read, Sydney was one of the largest cities in the English-speaking world. In this place, Sydney, then, that the newspapers of the city were always praising, Zoe's mother and father held moderately conspicuous positions. Knew everyone. Knew where to go for what and whom to see. Knew who was the leader in each particular field. Knew how to ask and grant favours. Now, from these very parents who were regarded by strangers as quite special, Zoe had learned that she surpassed them in all things just because she was herself. She and Russell were greatly taken notice of. Russell was never affected by the propaganda, having a life of his own from the start. Zoe took attention and praise for granted, as though they were part of the public utilities, like running water and electricity. She was quite sated with the interest turned on her, but did not think it unjustified. World-weary as any international success, so confident that few opinions could move her. Fearless, 17, she watched the three amateurs massacre her father's nerves down on the court. Her father, Clive Howard, Dr. Howard. He should have been a farmer. He had a rural sort of face. He looked at home, leaning on a hoe. Her mother was contented in the country, on holidays, taking a batch of scones from an old fuel stove, playing pioneers. They stayed with distant relations on a sheep station hundreds of miles from the city. Her father rode. Her mother gardened and gossiped. It was like a luxurious camp in the desert, but they fitted in, not seeming artificial there. Out in the bush, their city lives were like rolls thrust on them accidentally, rolls that made them unconsciously sigh. They were nice and able and accomplished, but innocent, Zoe thought, and knew nothing much about anything real compared with Russell, except worms or starfish or flies. Of course, uxorious described them too. Uxorious. Zoe recognized that her own life was harmonious partly because of it. But for some years, she had felt the pressure of a too warm and close parental interest in her future as a lover. Their prospective delight intruded on her sense of herself as a private person. Like voyeurs, she thought, sensing they wished to advise, to be present, to take part almost. So, I can't get past. Holding a tray, Mrs. Howard stood at the side of her supine and apparently unconscious daughter. Oh! Long chairs scattered about barricaded off one half of the veranda. Contrite, Zoe took the heavy tray over to the table, eyeing the glasses, ice, fruit juice, and various bottles. I was thinking about parents and orphans. She flashed a smile across her shoulder. While in passivity, her face, with its light grey eyes and fine bone structure, was more than pleasing. In animation, it could be beautiful. Her smile was always astonishing, causing the recipient to pause and inwardly acknowledge that some boon or blessing had unexpectedly been granted. So her mother paused briefly now, never having grown used to these dazzlingly varied and unpremeditated glances. "You only think of orphans in fairy tales," Zoe straightened the glasses on the tray. "Wandering in hand out of the woods, all misty and neglected and bedraggled. I've never met one before." "That's not to say they don't exist," her mother pointed out. "When I think of some of my students, I realize that you lead a very sheltered life." "I do?" Zoe gave an incredulous laugh. "The captain of the school. Editor of the paper, with the staff leaning heavily on her. Did they suppose she was given those marks out of pure philanthropy? And what about sailing? Had she not won more races there on the harbour than any girl of her age? She was a concert goer. She could handle a movie camera with some skill and a car better than her father. She could cook. With the few boys who had an interest in politics, she had attended meetings of every shade and been introduced by print to the prophets and their disciples. She had read millions of books. Although she was fortunate and wanted nothing, of her own accord, from childhood, she had noticed poverty when she saw it in the streets. Mentally, she had dealt with it all. Abracadabra. Misery abolished. In her imagination, as something between a game and a duty, people and buildings were transformed. Now she was older, and transformations were harder, but she had helped to raise money for charity. And with a church group, she had visited old people in their own homes for a few weeks or months, 2 or 3 years ago. Virtue on virtue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.